half a sheep covering.
The arts of the Etheria.
The Etheria.
Three portals. Now, I suspect that there are two themes as to these portals. One, that you have the three figures. In this depiction, you have the three figures. The two outer figures would not only represent human figures assisting the ritual, with the mage in the center, in this case being Jesus, and Jesus as the pillar, as it's trying to show you there. They whip him, they try to bind him with the pillar. It's all symbolic.
People are pillars.
So you have the two figures to the outside assisting energetically the figure in the center. Now these would be in human form, but also further entities as well, such as elemental cherubim, if you will. Another aspect would be that the three portals would represent the three symbolic journeys within occultism. So the actual square-shaped portals may represent that as well, as they are constructed in light in the astral planes. Researcher Richard Cassaro has certainly documented the three doorways very well across various cultures and around the planet. He has done a superb job. Now, of course, within Freemasonry, we can see this. And interestingly, in this depiction here, you can see the three figures in the doorways. And in part, I suspect that, yes, you have the three figures, that trinity in the doorways, and the doorways kind of represent the aura in part, in some cases, around the doorway, especially where you have the archway. But also where you have the straight sides and roof architecture, then that is possibly another aspect to it, but still with these three portals, as we will get into. But if we look at the notion of the mage in the middle with the two cherubim at the sides, that is also perhaps a reflection also of this three doorway configuration. I am saying perhaps. So Richard Cassaro hints with his book cover and so forth about light and stone into light. Whether he's doing this on purpose or not, I'm not quite sure. But anyway, that's what I see there. And beyond that, Richard Cassaro also gets into the third eye chakra, among other aspects also, the Ajna chakra. Now, I've taken my own shots of the three entryways, and in this case, in Canberra, you can see the Templar Employment Agency there with those three doorways once again outside. Now, in many cases, the first doorway will be larger than the two outer doorways. And in a way, I think this is why, in part, some of this relates to the ubiquitous configuration of the larger mage in the center with the two smaller cherubim at the outside assisting the ritual. But for now, let's look at some of these three doorway or three portal configurations that I've documented.
Thank you. about this earth over time, in today's money, trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars spent on edifices that the public is unaware of, that resemble the light structure around the human body, the changeable light structure of the human body, the further entities that assist in rituals, that come in rituals, the nature spirits, the building angels also, that create structures from astro-etheric matter, as seen by the human participants under clairvoyant sight when up through the chakras. I'm very confident that a certain amount of educated and initiated women out there who have been in rituals know all about what Elizabeth Arden is secretly telling people. With the three portals in mind, I will now proceed to read from page 197 under the three symbolic journeys within Charles Leadbeater's novel, The Hidden Life in Freemasonry. So reading, the three symbolic journeys. When a man joined the lesser mysteries in Greece or Egypt, it was considered that the first and most important teaching to be given to him was the truth about conditions after death, since they felt that a man must die at any moment and therefore be in possession of that knowledge. We continue that practice to the present day, and as a prominent part of that teaching, we take the candidate on the three symbolic journeys. There are three portals, or doorways, through which the candidate must pass. They are invisible to physical eyes, but are nevertheless perfectly real, because they are made of thought. The first one, as had already been explained, is an emblem of death, the passing out of the physical world into the next stage of life in the lowest part of the astral plane. The candidate enters without sight into that world, but feels the touch of a friend who takes the hold of his hand or arm and guides him on his journey. This friend is the junior deacon, who it will be remembered represents the astral or emotional principle in the human constitution. The IG, which I presume is inner guard, the IG presides over the first portal on behalf of the right worshipful master, of whom he is an expression on the physical plane. For the sake of this video, I'm going to miss out a paragraph and resume reading. So, as the candidate approaches the worshipful junior warden's pedestal, he arrives at the second portal and is there introduced to the elementals of earth and water, whom are related to the region through which he has just symbolically come, which may be thought of as consisting of the solid and liquid subplanes of the astral world. First he turns to the north and makes a suitable offering to the earth elementals, and then to the south to make his offering to elementals of the water. They are not the same creatures as those who were engaged in building the temple, but they stand quite definitely under their captain, who in turn obeys the worshipful junior warden as the guardian of the second portal. These elementals, which are of the kind sometimes called nature spirits, gather round and recognize thenceforth a man who has been presented to them. After this ceremony, should the man find himself in any kind of non-physical danger or in the presence of a malignant influence, he can draw around him a bodyguard of these beings on account of the brotherhood with them that has now been established. Now, this drawing in of the elementals as a bodyguard, In my experience, I actually had a high Freemason. He was under the 31st degree and above the 25th degree here in Sydney, Australia, in the presence of his wife, actually, describe this exact scenario. I asked him what he does when he's in danger of, say, various nefarious spirits. And he said exactly this. He said to me that he draws around him the elementals, as I recall. So what is written in here, I've actually heard that in person from a high-up Freemason. I will now read on in regards to plate 10 within this book. So plate X, or plate 10, is an attempt to show the appearance of this portal. The worshipful junior warden is seen seated at his pedestal, which is, as it were, within the thickness of the wall of the second portal. Over his head floats the sphere of his diva representative, who is surrounded by his band of assistants. Now, just to point out here that there are many other representations of entities within orbs such as this. It happens over and over and over and over and over and over again. But to read on. At the right-hand side of the portal, the earth elementals are grouped, and on the left side, those of the water. Tricksy sprites, ready to play with great gusto their part of resisting intrusion upon their domain until the candidate is properly presented to them and demonstrates his friendly intentions by a formal offering. For the purpose of clearness, we omit from this illustration all that is not necessary for our object. The candidate and the junior deacon who is leading him are not shown, nor are the brethren in the columns. So just note this for a moment. So I point this out with other things where in the past I've put orbs where orbs aren't, I've put pillars of light where pillars of light aren't, and then I'll find the government representing it, and then I'll find Google with their game Ingress putting putting orbs and sort of objects in the same positions. So I'm quite used to this. So here we have, within this book here, we have objects or people in this case being kept out of the illustration. And another thing to note is that it's talking about nor are the brethren in the columns, the people as pillars in a way. This is talked about over and over again, and I never really fully go into this actually, even though I keep repeating it. You know, it's written about many times, but nonetheless. So, reading on, only the worshipful senior warden appears in the distance, seen faintly through the second portal. The third portal is of course close to his pedestal, but as it is exactly similar in shape to the second, though differing in colour, no attempt is made to represent it. Reading on, it is the quality of discrimination between the higher and the lower, between the real and the unreal, which has enabled the candidate to pass scatheless through these regions of the astral world. The junior deacon, seeking passage for his charge, tells the elementals that he is a blinded child of mortality, seeking immortality. Passing through their regions in the course of his pilgrimage to the higher planes, the candidate is prepared to give up all things that belongs to them. All that matter which appertains to these levels, earth to earth and water to water. In this region after death must linger all those who cling to the low grade of emotional existence that embodies itself in this order of matter. Only when they have become purified through suffering and are ready to give up their low emotions can they shake off this matter from their astral bodies and pass to higher parts of the astral plane. The candidate will not linger here, for discrimination has taught him that there are better things. He must henceforth be recognized as one of the brothers of light and immortality. not in a state of darkness so far as his level is concerned. I will now skip another paragraph and read on. The candidate arrives at the third portal near the pedestal of the worshipful senior warden who is its guardian. There, facing east, he is introduced to the elementals of the air who guard the right side of the portal, and facing west to the elementals of the fire who guard its left side. Now, I just thought I'd read a few passages as I have done through this book. Anyone could read it. So this perhaps relates to those three portals. So we have those three portals on the Masonic floor, if you will. Etheric portals built by building angels. And this is really where all this sort of stuff comes from, combined with rituals. One thing to note within plate 10 with the elementals is that you can see the what appears to be an apron included there, and also the kind of sash around the neck as well, adornments that you would see within Freemasonry, and this would perhaps apply with the robes and so forth also, that these garments actually flow through and are used with by spirits within the further spirit world, strangely enough. So I know this is sort of tricky stuff, but we've talked about the three portals. It's certainly written about by Leadbeater. Within the film, The Fifth Element, you can see the mage in the center. Within that configuration, you have the configuration of the pedestals with the elemental energies going into the center. And you can see in this shot, the entities coming in also within the configuration, within all of that greater configuration with the energies going in, but the entities also there within that shot. And what I would suggest is assisting the mage in the center with either an uplift of the chakras and so forth, uplifting through the chakras or energizing the Eta and Pingala, for example, within that scenario. So there are the three there, and that would perhaps be represented by various the threes in the doorways. And also the three portals, perhaps like the temple of the like a representation also of structures, etheric structures built by building angels and so forth on the Masonic floor in the astral. So I'll leave it at this, and goodbye for now.